Wait, you have a TV?
No, I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide, you don't need a TV.
Hey everybody, it's Ken Reed here. It's Wednesday. That may be the weirdest hey I've done to start the show off. It was kind of pubescent. It sounded like I was surprised a little bit by my own voice, like it was the first time I ever spoke. I'm really too much in my own head right now. Let's just get into it. You're not being paid to be my therapist. It's TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, as always, your TV Guidance Counselor. And my guest this week is comedian Kenice Mobley. Kenice is a former Boston comic. She didn't quit. She just moved to New York City for bigger and better things. And she is doing bigger and better things. She is doing really well. She's really funny. She just recently did the Bridgetown Comedy Festival, which is one of my favorites in the world, even though I've only done ones in America. But let's pretend it's like the World Series in baseball, and it's only things in America. This was their 10th year. But this isn't a podcast about the Bridgetown Comedy Festival. This is a podcast where someone picks an old edition of TV Guide, they write down what they'd watch that week, and then we discuss their choices, and Kenice did that very thing. She's also a twin, which weirds me out. But her twin wasn't here. But I imagine, actually, that would be very interesting if I got twins to do the show and had them choose separately and see what they picked. It would be like, sort of like The Love Connection, but not because that's creepy because they're twins. But you get what I mean. Anyway, please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Kenice Mobley.
She is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Kenice Mobley, how are you?
Hi, I'm doing well. How are you?
Good. Thank you so much for trekking through the horrible weather with me in my four-wheel drive vehicle. From Oak Grove Station. Was it the first time you've been to Oak Grove Station?
No, I've been to Oak Grove before.
What is your thoughts about Oak Grove generally?
It looks kind of like what I imagine Eastern European sadness looks like.
It's Eastern Bloc,
yes,
right?
It's like concrete and just colorless and,
it's a prime example of what I think is described as beige age culture, which would be like late 70s, early 80s, like 77 to 83.
Yeah.
Where they're just like concrete and orange.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah, burnt umber. Yeah. No one has picked Oak Grove as their favorite place in Boston on your podcast, right?
No one has done that. I don't think anyone ever will. I think I'm safe there.
What's your favorite place in Boston?
That's tough. It's probably a restaurant that I go to a lot. I really like Felipe's, and I really like... This is a silly one, but it charms me so much. In the back of the Dosa Factory, they built another restaurant. So
you go a secret restaurant?
Well, it's not that. I mean, I guess it has advertising, but people don't know that it's there because it's literally in the back of the Dosa Factory, which is
weird.
Grocery store up front. And then people would be surprised to find out that Dosa Factory has a restaurant.
So that's in Central Square.
Central Square. But then you go past the groceries to the restaurant, and you just look to your right, and there's a whole completely different aesthetic restaurant.
Weird.
In the back of Dosa Factory called Bao Nation.
And it's Indian food?
No, it's Chinese food. It's
totally
different.
Oh, that's extra weird.
Yeah.
That's super weird.
It's just a completely different thing.
That's very strange. We when we lived in Somerville, there was a place called Vinny's that was like a little convenience store that people would buy like scratch tickets and the newspaper and stuff.
Right.
But it had like a speakeasy restaurant in the back that no one knew about for years, and then it got kind of popular, so that it's less of a convenience store now.
Okay.
But it was really weird. It was like a separate door. It was in the back.
The
food was amazing.
I love
homemade
stuff like
Italian
that.
Food. They had a cat that lives in the restaurant.
According to code, is that
fine? I don't know. I mean, he would catch the mice and stuff.
Oh, okay, yeah.
If you wanted to use the bathroom, it was in the kitchen. Food unbelievable. I'm not really selling it well here. But
pee in the kitchen, and then there's a cat that walks around and you eat it.
Yeah, that's a spicy meatball. Mamma mia. But yeah, that was, I like places like that that are like, you're not, there's a place in Somerville that's totally a mob front, and it's a bowling alley in Ball Square that I've never seen it open. One day it was open.
Oh.
And I went in there, and they were like, what are you doing in here? I was like, I want a bowl. As members only. Yeah.
Yeah, that has to be. I've walked by that. I used to live over there, and I was just like, How can it stay in business if this is never open?
Yeah. Yeah. And that area has a real claim to fame on television. I don't know if you know this, and I don't mean to blow you away here. Good thing you're sitting down. Yeah. But Kelly's Diner.
I've been there many times.
First episode ever of Diners, Drive-Ins, and Dives.
What?
Very first segment filmed right there. Pretty exciting, right?
What did they say? Like, the food there is so, like, run of the, like,
standard
right down the middle.
Diner. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, well, I don't even know why I went there. It was just like, oh, hey, they got American chop suey here. Yeah. That's not it. That's way more interesting than Guy Fieri sounds.
Yeah, yes.
But I Tony Danza'd him.
Oh.
Yeah. Hey, oh. Yeah, it's just a standard diner. And the weirdest thing about that place is, one of the great things about diners is they're usually open late. Their hours are like a bank. They're open like 10 to 2.
Yeah, that's it. If you, yeah. Fuck you if you want it at any other time.
Yeah. And yeah. The only place, I think there's more places open at night now in Boston to eat, but for years the only place was South Street Diner.
Yep.
And that was just, you would go there if you wanted pancakes so bad you didn't mind getting in a fight.
Yeah, I can see that.
That's really the only reason you'd go there.
I've been there late at night because it's like, oh, I've got to wait for a bus or a train or something.
Yeah.
And just like sitting there kind of with like other sad people who are just like, yep. Oh, my night didn't go as I hoped it would.
Yes,
so
yeah.
Now I'm here.
Well, I didn't think I'd be going home alone.
Yeah.
Well, time to take the bus back to Philly.
Right.
Wherever they're in town from. Yeah. There's always those guys outside the cell station too, trying to ask for bus fare home. Like they're trapped from.
Oh yeah.
So one kid,
I just need $2.63 more.
I was like, where are you going? And he said Worcester. And I went and bought a bus ticket to Worcester, which is like $5. I was like, here you go. And he was like, oh, I don't want that. And I was like, really?
Uh-huh, interesting.
I didn't think so. And then I gave it to someone who was actually going to Worcester.
Nice.
Fine, Worcester. But so you did not grow up in this area.
I didn't at all.
So it's interesting to have a favorite place here.
Yeah.
But you grew up in North Carolina?
I did. Charlotte, North Carolina.
Okay. The place that North Carolina is known for.
Yeah.
It's where the Hornets are from.
It's yes, it is where the Hornets are from. And we were so mad when they moved to New Orleans for like a quick second.
Yeah.
And we got them back, which is it's a point of pride for me.
But they didn't come back with Larry Johnson.
No.
And he wasn't dressed as Grandmama.
No, that didn't happen. They're not. They're also not that good.
Like, no, I don't know anything about them other than that the colors of their uniforms are kind of fun.
Yeah.
It's like yellow and purple or something?
It's purple and teal.
Purple and teal. Yeah. Perfect.
It's perfect. It was perfect for the 90s, though.
Yes.
Like,
yeah.
It was amazing.
If you're going to buy a starter jacket,
yes.
You want it to be purple
yes.
and teal. Yeah. So Charlotte is fairly urban? It's like a city?
Yeah,
city?
It's like the city in North Carolina.
Okay.
So
were
it's
you
the
in the suburbs?
City. Yeah, so technically in Charlotte still, but definitely if you look at it from above, like if you're landing on a plane, it is like the very standard little boxes all lined up.
Okay.
There were three models for houses in my neighborhood, and I knew you could either have an A model, a B model, or a C model across the street. They had a right. modified A, and I was
right.
like, oh, I don't even need to ask you where the bathroom is. I know where the bathroom
I'm
is.
I'm just going to go to the bathroom.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which yeah. is where if you sleepwalk and you're in a B and you think you're in an A, that's a problem.
It could be real risky.
Yeah, that happened to my sister once. She used to sleepwalk, and we used to go down to Rhode Island every summer. And where the bathroom was in our house was where the living room was at this house in Rhode Island. And we were all in there watching TV, and she just came in and peed. And it was like The Exorcist. It was literally like that scene in The Exorcist.
That would terrify me.
Yeah, yeah. We're like, don't wake her up. So that was interesting.
Yeah. God.
You came up here for school, right?
Yes. I went to BU for grad school.
Ah, the boo.
Yes.
The good old boo. What did you go to grad school for?
Film production.
No, I mean, why did you do that?
No. That is a very legitimate question,
yes.
given that I do not work in film production right now.
No one I know who has a film or any entertainment degree works in that field.
Yeah. It's,
including myself.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was a fun degree to get. I'm not going to deny that.
What did you want to do in production, like?
So I really liked production design, and I had produced a bunch of stuff. So
okay.
like I was the organized one in my friend group
yeah,
all
yeah.
the time. I organized events, whatever. So they were like, yeah, we just need somebody to do this. So I would like handle paperwork and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And then I
need those people.
Yeah. And then I went to L.A. because the end of the program takes place in L.A.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, I don't want to do this all the time. Like,
oh, really?
Or,
so
like, I mean,
I
worked on film sets. I was in the production design department for like a bunch of shorts and student things out there. And then it was just like, God damn, this is, I'm just going to go get this marketing job and be able to afford my rent all the time.
Yeah, because that's the thing. Any of the quote unquote fun jobs don't pay well because anyone will do them for free.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's not ideal. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, or I feel like the people who did the best in it, they had like parental support.
A trust fund.
Yes. Yeah. And they were like, oh, I can spend like a year just like making connections, working
finding
on things.
Finding my way.
Yeah. Like, and get a resume of things until you're paid versus like, right. No, I need to pay my bills like yesterday.
I need to eat food.
Yes.
Yeah.
And also like, I wasn't older than my friends, but I know that I'm a bit... My sister likes to say bougier, I guess.
Bougier?
Yeah, like bougie.
Like bourgeois?
Yeah. Like, oh, bougie. Like, oh, you've been all fancy bougie. Because I'd be like...
Oh, like stuck up.
Yeah, well...
You think you're better than me? Is that North Carolina for you think you're better than me?
No, I think it's black for, like, you think you're better than me. Like,
oh, is that a black term?
Oh,
bougie?
Yeah, bougie. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's...
Yeah, I'm incredibly white. I don't know. I actually did a DNA test recently.
And it said, oh my God,
yeah,
white.
Yeah, basically, it was... Because, like, normally people do it and they're like, I found out I'm actually, like, 30% Arab or whatever. Mine was literally 97% British Irish and then, like, 2% other Western Europe. Very disappointing. It was very disappointing. Yeah. But North Carolina, they shoot a ton of stuff down there. And probably were when you were growing up, right?
So they filmed parts of Dawson's Creek there. Like, the WB, I think, was filming
big
a
time.
Bunch there. So Wilmington has, like, or had not as much anymore based on, like, tax breaks. Took a lot of things down to Atlanta or up to, in some instances, Boston.
Because, like, Walking Dead's in Atlanta.
Yeah.
But, like, the Dino... Tyler Perry's...
His entire empire is in Atlanta.
He has a whole studio down there, right? Yeah. Dana Gould did his show Stand Against Evil in North Carolina.
Did he?
Yeah, and Stranger Things was in North Carolina.
Because the Duffer brothers are from North Carolina.
Oh, that makes sense.
I think they went to North Carolina College of the Arts. Like, it's a decent arts college, but a lot of...
But you were
people.
Like, I'm going to Boston.
Well, I did not get in there.
Okay. So, I see.
Yeah. Also, I didn't find out I wanted to do film, which is fine, until I was, like, a junior in undergrad.
Okay. What were you going to... Where were you going to undergrad?
North Carolina Central University.
Okay.
It's very small.
NCCCU.
NCCU,
yeah. Yeah, okay.
And I was majoring in history and psychology, and like I was like, I'm gonna go become a psychologist.
Okay.
I'm gonna do research because I worked on a lot of experiments with like kids and like how they develop their ideas of self and also their ideas of race.
You experimented on children.
I did.
Yes,
a lot actually. Yeah. I have done a lot of strange experiments.
That's why everyone calls you Skinnerbox.
Yeah. Sometimes you never know.
Yeah. Skinnerbox, total bouge.
So, but then I was like, actually, I don't really want to do that. That's just my history is just me being like, do I really want to do that?
I don't know if I want to do that.
Stand-up is the thing
that's
that
the
I've
one
stuck
you're staying with?
Yeah,
okay.
Like longer than anything else. I've been like, no, I think I want to keep doing this.
Well, it is the most financially lucrative.
Yes, so,
and you meet the best people.
Yeah, I am so wealthy. Yes. My bouginess from childhood is now completely justified.
Yes, you have your own island.
I do.
Off the coast of North Carolina.
It's pretty, I mean, yeah, you got to fight the racists and the people
True.
Who are very concerned about where people pee.
Yeah.
But once you do that, it is amazing.
Yeah. I wonder if the people down there, like, if there's a hierarchy on their hate. Like, if, like, a trans person is lower than a black person, or, like if they're like, oh, I have to let one of these people pee in my bathroom.
Yeah.
Is it just, like, a Sophie's choice, or are they like, well, easy choice?
In North Carolina, there are some, like, very clear, like, I don't like coloreds. I don't like,
really?
Like this. Like, yeah, oh, especially on the eastern part of the state, like, very clear, they have the Confederate flag in their lawn. They know, like,
ooh.
Oh, they are solid with hate.
Yeah.
But then there are so many people in North Carolina who are like, I'm a good person. I just think it's more complicated if we have to accept these other people.
I just think they'd be happier with their own kind.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So they're just like, I'm not full of hate. I'm a nice person.
Yeah.
But I will vote against your interest every time.
Why? You're the intolerant one.
Yes.
You do not represent my beliefs that you are inhuman.
Yes. Exactly.
Yeah.
Oh,
that
is a perfect summation of much of North Carolina.
That is terrifying. It's so weird because Boston does have a racist reputation.
I was told, before I came to grad school here, my professors, and this is, to give context, one of the things that my school is known for is being where the female in the Duke Lacrosse rape case went.
Okay.
And there was a bunch of racial shit going on in Durham at the time.
Yeah.
It was really messed up. That was like my entire junior year of college was like dealing with some of that stuff. Because like there were just camera crews on our campus all the time.
Yeah.
Durham was just a mess.
And you're like, I want to go into this field.
Yeah. I told my professors, I was like, I think I'm going to go to Boston University.
Yeah.
And they're like, you're going to go to Boston? Boston is so racist. And I'm like,
did you find it to be?
I dealt like in BU, you're only dealing with people who aren't really from there. Like,
yeah, there's a lot of people from the Middle East.
Yeah. There was one chick I met who had a Boston accent, and we all made fun of her. So, like, there weren't real Bostonians.
Most people from Boston aren't smart enough to go to BU.
Yeah. So, I met a lot of people who just, like, it wasn't, like, in the South, it's, like, based on having been around black people and being racist.
Yeah.
But here, it's just been, like, I've never met a black person, and I have legitimate, like, I have all these questions that I've never been able to ask someone. You're the first. Let me ask you all these questions.
So it wasn't so much a racism as just, like, an ignorance?
Yes.
Yeah, and I always, and I've described Boston this way before, is that it's not racist, it has an artisanal xenophobia, where they just hate everyone who's not them.
Yes.
Like, it's just like, you don't live in my fucking house. I don't fucking know you. And it's a weird, there has been some for sure awful racist things in the past year, but it's very different. And when I would travel down south, it's a whole different ballgame.
Yeah.
Of how the racism
is. Like, we
is
have
there.
A list of reasons why we specifically don't like each group of people.
Yeah.
Like, we thought about it.
Don't like your food.
Yeah.
Don't like your music. Don't like how you're killing our women.
Yeah.
It's like,
we don't like how you pray. We all pray. We're all overly into praying, but we all do it very differently, and it's important that everyone should know that ours is the best way.
Right. Our God is the best God.
Yeah.
When I drove down from here to do some shows in North Carolina and South Carolina, when we were driving between North and South Carolina, not the United States, it was so weird on the highway because it was like mega church, porno store, cigarettes, porno store, church, cigarettes, porno store.
Yeah.
It was like, that was it. And dead dogs all up and down the roads.
Well, because they'll hit them. And what, you want me to stop my car?
Well, somebody in South Carolina, fucking... I was like, first of all, I don't know if this is just a South Carolina thing, but like, if I was to say something and you didn't understand me, you'd be like, oh, excuse me or pardon me. Could you say that again? They go, do what now? Is that a South Carolina thing?
Do what now? Say what now?
It was so aggressive. Yeah. And I instantly kicked in. I was like, dude, fuck you. Like, I was so mad. But I asked someone and they were like, oh, well, hunting season's over. And I'm like, what?
So they're like, shooting the dog?
They just let him go.
Oh.
So they're like
running around and then they'll get hit.
I was
and then
like, this is horrible. And it was a person who I was actually kind of surprised that they were like so nonchalant about it.
Yeah.
They're like, it was hunting season. I'm like, what the fuck is wrong with you?
I will say that I am from farm people, and there is certainly like a, animals serve a utilitarian purpose. It isn't like, it's a pet kind of, like, I guess you feed it and you're around it, but like, I had two dogs, both of them outside dogs. They would, like, we'd feed them, but they'd also like kill rabbits and stuff. Like,
yeah, they worked for you.
Yeah, exactly. It was like an animal is like for a purpose. And so they're like, well, the purpose is done. So.
Because meanwhile, I have my poodle like in bed with me and we just hug
so
this
much.
Thing. Yeah. Oh, it's ridiculous. Yeah.
I wish I had that ability. Like, yeah. I'm just like, it's not going to pay for me to be in a nursing home. I don't know. What do you want
to do? Yeah. But I'm like, he might chew my jugular out so I don't have to go to a nursing home when I'm invalid on the floor. That's what I've trained him to do.
Once you become invalid,
He's like, he's a euthanasia dog.
Oh, nice.
I call him a comfort dog, but that's just more of a top level version of it. Nice. I don't drill down to the euthanasia part for most people.
I appreciate you sharing that with
me. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
If it goes south, he will take me out. That's
good
what he's
know.
It for. Yeah. That's why his name's Cyanide. We call him Cy. A lot of people don't know his full name. So when I asked you what year you wanted, you said 99 or 2004.
Yes.
Why? That's a big gap.
Yes.
Why those two specific years?
So as a kid, and I didn't realize it really until going through this TV guide, how much TV I watched, but like my family watched so much TV together, and like that shifted a little bit because I got busier in high school.
Yeah.
So I knew like before high school, like so end of middle school, 99. I was watching a lot of TV during high school, super busy watching less, but 2004, like right before I graduated high school, I think I picked
you
up.
Checked out and had some time on your hands?
Yeah. I'm watching TV again.
A big family. You have a couple siblings or just one?
I have an identical twin sister.
That's right.
Yeah. And then an older sister who's 8 years older. So she wasn't around when we were watching all this TV, but like every night it would be like, now that I realized, it'd be like, oh, this is whatever. It's fine. It would be like some Wednesdays were for the church group.
Yep.
And then every other night we're watching TV together.
Like, did kids give you a ton of sister crap?
Oh, all the time.
Yeah.
They're like,
I imagine
you're
that.
Black, you're twins.
Yeah.
You like Tia Tamara.
It's on right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
You guys do this? I mean, that's just twin stuff. But.
Did you guys ever do twin stuff like pretend you were each other or like mess with people?
We did once. We switched classes to see if we could, and we could so well, in fact, that it was like I don't know if this is every school in middle school, but we had rotating books. So, like, you had a small book that covered, like, a particular science topic. So,
okay.
Like, this would be geology. This other one would be, like, weather patterns.
Pseudopods. I don't know if that merits a whole book, but...
This one would be like chemistry, this one, and so you'd have all these different books, and because we could only afford like two sets of each, like the classes, so there'd be like seven different classes you'd have
to like stagger the topics.
Yes. So there was a pop test in her class, and I was like, actually, this is just like a funny thing we did where like I'm Kenice. Yeah. And she's like, are you in the seat? And I'm like, yeah. She's like, well, then you're taking the test. And so I failed a chemistry test for my sister.
So you've never done that again.
And she was like, we're never doing this again.
Have you ever seen the Richard Pryor movie Moving?
No.
It's later period Richard Pryor, but it's actually, I really enjoy the movie. Mm-hmm. And it does have a wonderful cameo appearance by Morris Day in it. But he's really funny.
Just him or the times?
Just him.
Okay.
Not playing Morris Day, like just playing like a guy in it. The plot is that that Richard Pryor gets a new job across the country and he has to move there and it goes horribly wrong.
Right.
But he has twin sons, and when they get to their new school, the sons pretend there's only one of them. So like when they're registering, it was like, oh, there's two names there. And the kids are like, oh yeah, that's my middle name. And so one of them just spends all day in the bathroom and they swap out. So they only have to go to like half the classes.
Nice.
And I was like, oh man, that'd be great.
Yeah.
Like they go tag off and it's fantastic.
Yeah.
So if only you had seen Moving, you guys could have figured
something
done
out
that,
like
yeah. that. So 8 o'clock.
We also went to the same college, so we could have done that for a long
weird.
Time.
Oh, that's weird. Yeah. Did it confuse people?
People were just like, oh, I guess you guys are really close or so. I don't know what your deal is. But we're very different also.
Right. Did you have like your own language and that kind of stuff as kids?
Oh, no. I mean, it's, I guess I have to say that it sounds like that because we have watched so much of the same media, been around so many of the same people.
Yeah, the reference.
Yeah. So it's just like reference. Yeah. Like this is like that one time when Denise Fleming got a brownie thrown at her head.
You have an experienced shorthand,
yes.
but not like a pig Latin.
No, not like a pig Latin. It's just like, oh, I felt like bleh. And she's like, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Right.
So,
I had a friend of mine who is also an identical twin. Her sister's a comedian. And, my friend came to a show that I did in LA, and another comic that I know was there didn't know my friend but knew her comedian's sister.
Right.
Didn't know that she was a twin and was like, she's been really rude to me. Like, she's not saying hello because she'd never met her.
Yeah.
And she didn't know she was a twin. And I was like, she's a twin. She has a twin sister.
Yeah.
And she was like, fuck you. And I'm like, no.
No, really?
That's because it sounds like such a made up
yes.
thing. Because that's very rare. But I weirdly know a lot of twins.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very strange.
And make friends. Strange. I feel like the shared experience of like, I swear I'm my own person. Like,
yeah.
acknowledge you. Like, so like me and, you know, Amy Rose Ranger?
Yeah. She's also a twin. Yeah.
Yeah. So we hang out a lot in New York. Yeah.
yeah. Just... Are you sure it's her they're hanging out with?
I've been to, she lives with her twin sister. So
oh,
like
that's
I.
That's super freaky.
Yeah.
yeah. That is very weird. Yeah.
So,
have you ever gone to like any of those twin conventions or anything like that?
No, we got mailings for like the Minnesota Twin Project. So we had to like fill out like every couple of months, we'd have to fill out like a questionnaire about like
right.
our different thoughts on things or like
right.
how we were the same or different, I guess.
Did you ever get results on it?
No. And we just, I filled this out for years,
Did
actually.
You both find out that you're 97% white?
Yes. That 3%, very powerful.
It is really
it
powerful.
Is, yeah. I was like,
it is a dense amount
yes.
of, yeah. I've never met anyone more than twins, though. Like, I've never
like
met anyone triplets or quads or...
There were triplets.
Quinties.
Oh,
I don't know if quinties is the word. Seps.
Seps. I think there were triplets who, like, hung out in the... Like, we would, there would be parties across schools, and there was a pair of triplets at one of the schools, and people were like, yeah, they're kind of weird. It was like two girls and a boy.
What the hell's going on down there?
Oh, like the water?
In North Carolina,
oh, yeah. Oh, because like around the corner from us, there was another set of twins. There were a lot of twins in my neighborhood.
What's up with that?
Do
you think it has something to do with the environment?
Maybe.
Is it all the tobacco?
Yeah, all the tobacco. The fact that it's just, it's like weird, like all of our soil is clay. So it's like weird water stuff. Yeah, it's a weird place.
It's the clay phenomenon.
Yes.
That makes perfect sense.
Of course, the clay.
Have you ever heard about that weird Nazi village in Brazil with all the twins?
I don't like this. I don't like that. I haven't heard of this. I haven't, what?
There's a village in Brazil, because a lot of the Nazis fled
yeah.
to Brazil. And it has like a 200% higher instance of identical twins than the whole world. And it's this really small village and they're all like blue-eyed, blonde-haired. And it's not even like a weird, like it's that's a real thing.
You sure? Like, because those Nazi scientists were doing some stuff. And do you think this is just like a continuation?
That's
of
what
their,
people
like...
think.
Yeah.
But they're just like, no, I don't know. It's just a thing. It's really weird. I forget the name of the town, but
have they like formally apologized for being Nazis though?
Well, I don't think the twins are Nazis.
Okay, if they're like parents.
But they did find a lot of the ex-Nazis living there.
Okay.
Who have since been found and executed.
Okay, cool. Just, you know, I have, since the election, I've even more so hardened my stance against Nazis.
Yeah, I don't think my stance could have gotten any harder against yeah. Nazis. I'm pretty much at Black Diamond level.
Yeah.
I'm a Black Diamond level Nazi hunter.
Right.
But, yeah. You know, and these ones are even worse because they don't even dress well.
Yeah,
Like Hugo Boss, at least.
Yeah, those were some sharp outfits.
Yeah,
but
they had
these
a logo.
Guys, hoodies.
Yeah,
fucking garbage.
They don't even have a logo.
They don't have a logo. They also they're like, those people were in the military. They're like in shape. These are like just mobs. I can't.
Yeah. No, they're the people who are in that movement now are literally the fat, lonely, basement-dwelling losers
men
who
rights
have been
activists,
empowered
like, yeah.
on the internet because they're just filled with rage and have no outlet.
Yeah.
And they somehow got some amount of, I don't even want to say credibility, but it's very, very weird.
Yes.
And when Richard Spencer got punched, which was fantastic, a friend of mine who's in a punk rock band up here got misidentified as the puncher. So he was getting like nonstop, like, you're fucking dead, man. Here's his address. Here's his get. And I think it was because when we were in punk rock bands growing up in Boston, we did encounter a lot of like neo-Nazi bands and like white power bands.
Right.
And would fuck with them. And because like,
fuck them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so I'm 99% sure some dude in one of those bands is on one of those boards and was like, yeah, it was this guy.
Dumb.
Yeah. Yeah. Ridiculous.
Yeah.
But so don't go to Brazil is what I'm saying. If you get invited to a twins convention in Brazil,
I won't go.
Avoid it. And also Brazil's also apparently a hellhole anyway.
Yeah. There's a lot of shit going on there.
A lot of kidnapping. Yeah. I remember I saw footage on the news of these Brazilians, just this guy had a baseball bat who's just hitting people on bikes. It was like the middle of the day. I don't even know why. And,
yeah.
A friend of mine, I used to work with from Brazil, and I was asking about that. He's like, oh, yeah, that happens. I was like, oh,
with
dear.
A bat.
Yep,
Jesus.
No problem. So anyway, we went with June 19th, week of June 19th, 1999.
Yes.
So 6999. which
I did not think about that, but totally on brand.
Totally perfect. And the Saturday night here, June 19th, what'd you go with?
So 8 o'clock, Rugrats.
So you're going full Nickelodeon here.
Yes, I went straight down the line.
Yeah.
Because I used to, my mom would be so annoyed, because in addition to watching TV together every night, we would also like cook a meal. Like so, we
oh,
have
like a full family thing.
Yeah, we'd sit down together for a meal, and I was always annoyed because I love her to death. She's a slow cook, and so we'd get served at like 7:45, right?
Right.
And so like, but the ma, SNICK starts at 8.
So you weren't allowed to eat while watching TV.
Or like we wanted to go closer to the TV.
I see.
Like
okay.
The TV's on so we can hear it, but we can't like see it so well. So like we would just like scarf, like we're all very slow eaters in my family, but we'd like scarf down food on Saturday. So we just like run.
So you'd make yourself ill to watch SNICK.
Yeah.
Yeah. And by 99, SNICK was not the SNICK I knew.
What was this?
So SNICK, the first year of SNICK was 92.
Okay.
I was so excited.
Yeah.
Because Nickelodeon was never on at night. It was always Nick at Night. And they did this one night a week and they launched it with Roundhouse, which is the worst show of all time.
Don't remember.
It was awful. It was like if the Fly Girls from Living Color tried to do sketch comedy mixed with the worst improv troupe you've ever seen. And they would do dramatic sketches sometimes. It was awful.
That
it's the most 90s
really
thing.
Bad.
Yeah. It's awful. So it was that. Clarissa Explains It All.
Remember that.
Adventures of Pete and Pete.
Love
Ren
it.
And Stimpy and Are You Afraid of the Dark?
Yes.
So by 99, I think it was more cartoons.
Yeah. There's one cartoon here. It was a straight SNICK block. So it's Rugrats and then 8:30, all that. And then 9 o'clock, Kenan and Kel, and then 9:30, Are You Afraid of the Dark?
So I was definitely checked out by then. but Rugrats is a show that I loved. This one is Grandpa Takes the Kids to a Wrestling Match. which is a good one.
Okay.
Former guest of the show, friend of the show, Melanie Chardoff, did the voice of Mrs. Pickles on the show.
Nice.
On Rugrats. And I did enjoy Rugrats, but I don't think I would have gone with that. In 99, let's see, I was 19. I just turned 19. This is my birthday week. And I was living in Somerville. I had my own apartment. I had just finished my freshman year of college. It was awful.
Oh,
so never mind. All of college was terrible.
Okay.
You know, I may have watched Rugrats because there's kind of nothing else on at 8 o'clock that was remotely interesting for me that night. Because you have a lot of, like, the Jesus-y shows, like Early Edition.
Right.
Which is the Saturday night show. You know, I might have gone with Cops. It's in Palm Beach, Florida. It's a repeat. But, you know, Cops is the go-to on a Saturday.
Nice.
8:30 went with All That. All That is a show that was just too young for me.
I loved it so much.
Because you're like 6 years younger than me. And it was probably the first sketch show you saw?
Yes, it was. So I was like, they're just being funny and it changes constantly. And it's just like, what?
And it was cool to see like people your age doing that kind of thing too. And, you know, out of Kenan and Kel, I'm surprised that Kenan's the one who went on to do stuff.
Yeah.
He was good, but Kel seemed like he had a career gone.
It constantly amazes me that I, for 20-some years, have watched Kenan Thompson on television.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Consistently.
Yeah.
As a sketch comedy performer.
Yeah.
Yeah. I did
That's
not see Fat Albert.
That's the arc that you'd want, I guess. I don't know. Yeah. 20-year career in sketch comedy?
It's just the show. I don't know what it was. It was just too young for me. Yeah. I guess that was it. You know, I'd been watching Kids in the Hall and SNL.
Oh,
years.
I never watched any of that stuff.
And then at 9 o'clock, you went with Kenan and Kel. So they had a spinoff show. I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
This one is The Boys Unwrap and Ruin Kenan's Birthday Gift.
That makes sense.
Doesn't sound that exciting.
It clocks, though. Good. There's always shenanigans. There's always, like, liquid will splash on someone or something will be broken or something very physical.
Let me guess. Misunderstandings?
Of course.
Perfect.
Yes.
I would have gone with Martial Law, which was definitely a show I watched then.
What is
it? It was an hour-long action drama starred Sammo Hung, who is a Chinese director and martial artist. He started in a group called The Seven Little Fortunes with Jackie Chan. They were like amazing martial artists.
Nice.
He's a fat guy. And so he did a series of movies in China called Fatty Dragon, but did a lot of weird comedies too. And so he had a TV show here called Martial Law, where he was a Chinese bounty hunter who was working with the US government.
What?
And it was almost like Walker, Texas Ranger, but with a Chinese guy. It was a really cool show.
Okay.
I think it was only on like two seasons, but it was a really great, cool show.
These things always strike me kind of just like a, who, what?
Well, we started to get the sort of Chinese invasion of media in the late 90s.
Yeah.
Where all of these guys that choreographed or directed Hong Kong movies, once Hong Kong was going to go back to mainland China, they all kind of defected over here. Mm-hmm. So that's where we got like John Woo came over and started making movies.
Yes.
The Matrix people, Corey Yoon, who directed all the fight scenes in that, Jackie Chan, and all those guys were kind of moving over here around that year. So that's kind of why I think we
got that. Got it. I was like,
but,
what?
And I'd been watching Sammo Hung in movies for years, so I was psyched that he was over here. This episode has a very special guest appearance by Arsenio Hall.
Nice.
And Sammo and Terrell, who's played by Arsenio Hall, nab a villain who runs sweatshops and sells the workers' babies.
What?
Meanwhile, Sammo gives Terrell martial arts lessons. So if you want to see a fat Chinese guy teaching Arsenio Hall martial arts, that alone is worth the show.
If this is on YouTube, I'm going to find it.
Oh,
it
definitely is.
Okay.
It's a fun show.
Okay.
I would encourage you to watch it. So that's an hour long, so I'm watching that all night. And then Are You Afraid of the Dark? Again, I had checked out by this point.
Yeah.
I didn't even know they were still making it in 99. But this one is, this one I remember. This one was terrible. A boy receives a legendary hockey player's stick.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, I have no interest in hockey at all.
I didn't grow up with it. It's not an important thing.
Do they have a hockey team in North Carolina?
We won the Stanley Cup once.
Oh, really?
When I was in college. Yeah, it's the Hurricanes.
Okay. That seems insensitive.
Yeah. You mean the thing that wipes off our
the
coast
natural
every
disaster that kills people
all
every
the
year?
Time, yep. Every year.
We're going to get the LA forest fires.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
That's very weird. So you didn't get all wrapped up in the bean pot when you were going to BU.
No.
Yeah,
I was like, I'm too old.
Yeah.
This is a very white sport. Like, this is a lot.
And they treat that hockey team like they are God's
I have
gift.
Heard this.
Yeah.
I'm happy.
Fuck those kids.
I was the TA for Comm 101, which is like the base level thing that you take.
As teacher's assistant, not tough ass.
Oh, yeah. Is that?
I don't know.
Okay.
BA is badass.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah. So I'm so happy that I never got anyone who was on any sort of sports team that I had to deal with and grade and have people be like, grade them differently. So.
Oh, did they? Do you think they did that there? I mean, I'm sure they did.
Yeah, without a doubt they did.
Yeah, I remember at Northeastern, which I sadly went to.
Why sadly?
That was not a good school. I don't know if it's different now, but it definitely wasn't then.
Okay.
But I used to waive my sports pass every year, and they would include that in the in your fee for going to school there.
Yeah.
And it was only like, I don't know, $100 or something. But I made up, I was like, no, I'm not paying that. I'm not going to go to any of these games.
Right.
So I had to fill out like 10 pages of paperwork. And they'd be like, you sure you want to do all this paperwork? I'm like, yes. If it takes me an hour, I just made $100 an hour.
Right.
I'm not just, they were so mad and so offended that I didn't just want to automatically give money towards the sports teams. No. And then the year after I graduated, they got rid of the football team at Northeastern because nobody went.
Yeah.
So they actually disbanded it. It was amazing. It was amazing. Good. Oh, and the kids on the team were crying. It was really...
Sorry, kids.
No, it was hilarious.
But yeah,
your
not
college
necessary.
Football team got disbanded and you cried? Come on. Sunday night, 8 o'clock.
All right, sister.
Oh, so you watched it even though it was a touchy
yes.
subject. Did you feel a kinship to it? Like, you're kind of like, it is like that.
It didn't necessarily speak to my experience because it's also like in addition to them living in a different place, having like a different neighborhood vibe. I don't know. There's just like their TV hijinks just didn't speak to what was going on with me, especially in 1999.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Did she go to detention for calling somebody a slut? Like,
oh,
what?
You had detention? Were you a bad kid?
I wasn't a bad kid.
Your problem?
I was kind of a mean girl in middle school.
Okay.
So it was
I
was lashing out.
Was she a slut, though?
Sophia? Yes, she was.
Oh, Sophia from Charleston? I don't know.
Yeah, Sophia moved to our school. This is, for some reason, when I was in 6th and 7th grade, the term porn star was, like, new to us, and they'd be like, porn star. Like, it was really weird.
Okay.
For 7th graders to be, like, putting, like, Playboy stickers on their things.
Well,
and,
you
like,
grew up with the internet.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, so, like, that was, like, a big hip thing.
Oh, it was, like, I'm a porn... Like, I'm a rock star.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And it'd be, like, oh, she's such a slut. And, like, now I don't say slut in the same way, but definitely it was, yeah, we were not nice to each other.
Oh, yeah. No, nothing is more evil than a teenage girl.
Yeah.
And Judge Judy mentions that every episode. Like, if there's ever a teenage girl involved in the case,
she's like, you're guilty.
Madam, you have the teenage girl's a liar and they're evil. Like, but I'm like, she's kind of right.
Yeah.
My favorite episode ever involved teenage girls from Brockton. And there's a clip online where this girl was harassing these boys, and I think they threw a snowball at her or something. And it was totally this girl's fault. She started with them. Joe Judy was like, why are you yelling at these boys, madam? Why did you stop this? And she goes, because they're losers.
She has 4 syllables in the word loser.
Yeah. And then she goes, this is not a fair justice, which was amazing.
What?
Yeah. Just go with your friggin' white trash, whatever. And oh, it was amazing. Yeah. But teenage girls, they're terrible.
Yes.
So this episode is Tia, Tamara, Davian, Tariq, and Jordan.
Uh-huh. Davian?
D-I-A-V-I-A-N. Davian?
I don't know.
Plan to spend spring break in Atlanta. Features musical artists. Ooh, you ready for this? Maya.
What? I love Maya.
And Teddy Riley.
I don't know how to tell you. Fuck that guy. But
Maya did that Ghetto Superstar song.
She did Ghetto Superstar. She also did the music for, guess what? The Rugrats movie.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. So she was big this year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Take me there. I want to go there. Do you remember?
Yes. Where is she? She just kind of disappeared.
Yeah, she did.
She was huge.
She did that, fuck yeah.
Who's the one that was in the Queen of the Damned and died?
Oh, that's Aaliyah.
That was around the same time though, right?
Yes. I think this, yeah, it was early 2000s, late 90s.
It seemed like they were rival, like they were the two.
But Aaliyah had something more. Aaliyah had, like, because, I mean, don't get me wrong, people were sleeping with Aaliyah way too early. Like, she was, like, 15, and I think she was, like,
dating.
Oh,
didn't she date R. Kelly?
Yeah, so, like, issues abound. But she was also an actress in a way that Maya was not.
Because I bet when she died, Maya was like, yes, now I don't have a rival anymore.
Yes.
And then no career.
Yeah.
That's
she was
really
in that, true. Christina Aguilera, Moulin Rouge.
Okay.
Maya, I think, was in that one.
And that was the last anyone saw or heard of her. Well, she's guest starring in this episode of Sister.
I haven't seen that. I haven't watched that.
I think this evening I am going to go with the E! True Hollywood Story, Farrah Fawcett.
Oh.
I loved any true Hollywood story. I watched those religiously, and 99 especially. Behind the Music, E2 Hollywood yes. Story, I was all in on those. So I'm watching
everyone
that.
Everyone had a yeah. sad story.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And at 8 o'clock, there's a TNT original movie, and I'm surprised that this was this early. It's The Pirates of Silicon Valley, and it's the true story
oh,
of the...
Oh, I remember yeah. that.
Noah Wyle.
I watched
yep,
this.
Steve Jobs and Anthony Michael Hall yes, as Bill Gates.
Yes, I watched this on TV.
99 seems really early.
On that night, I probably, if it came out around...
Yeah, this is the premiere.
Yeah, I watched it. Come on. That was what I was doing that night.
That was a huge... They made a huge deal out of that.
Yeah.
Because it was pretty contemporary as well.
Yeah.
That's sort of been forgotten about. We've had Jobs and that other
Steve
movie.
Steve Jobs.
Yeah. yeah. And there was the movie Jobs, though.
Yeah.
Where, did Ashton Kutcher play
yes.
it? Yeah. No one remembers Noah Wiley
playing,
was
yeah.
the real Steve Jobs.
But that was
Jobs.
Like a real... Like, I thought that... I mean, again, I was... 15 at the time, but I thought that was a legit good movie.
It was a pretty good movie. It was yeah. one of the first TNT original movies.
Yeah.
Yeah. Pirates of Silicon Valley. I'm going to have to revisit that because I totally forgot about that. Yeah. I'm going with that.
Nice.
And then 8:30, what'd you do?
Futurama.
So you didn't go Smart Guy. You didn't go the full family of Tia Tamara. Futurama, I love.
Yeah.
I didn't really watch it when it was first on, but it's one of those shows that when it's on now, I watch it and love it.
Yeah. I think it's smart, and I like, I don't know, I just like the characters a lot.
I actually think it's better than The Simpsons when I watch it. I feel
I
like
don't
it
really watch
more.
The Simpsons. So.
It's Futurama's better show.
Okay, nice.
I feel like it's a better show.
Good.
I think you're doing it right.
Good.
This episode is Fry throws Bender out onto the street after his roomie's antenna disrupts the cable feed at their new apartment.
Ah.
I don't remember that episode, but this is on a new day. This is the first time they moved it to Sundays in 99. It was on Thursdays, and then they moved it following The Simpsons on Sundays.
Yeah.
And then they moved it again, and then it got canceled. 9 o'clock, what'd you go with?
So from 9 to 10, I went with 2020.
2020 is the only show my parents didn't allow me to watch.
What?
It used to be on Friday nights at 10, so I would watch pre-TGIF, the show, the block that was on before that.
Yeah.
And then it would be followed by 2020. I was a super paranoid kid, so I was afraid of, like, the Moonies and medical waste and, like, everything that they showed on 2020.
Right.
Lap seat belts.
Yep.
Everything. So it was the only show I wasn't allowed to watch. And they moved it to Sunday nights, and I wasn't watching anymore at that point.
Wow. There were some episodes that they would do, like, these social experiments where they'd be like, what would you do if, like, you, like, saw this? And one about, like, the little hooks. Like, if you have, like, a hoodie and you want to tighten the hood section of it, and there would be little clips on the side, how those were getting caught in bus doors and killing children. Like,
and
that
people weren't helping them.
like the kid would get caught and the bus would start to pull away and then the kid would die. Like, that's
jeez. Like, yeah, so you haven't worn a hoodie since.
I mean, I don't really wear hoodies generally.
Yeah.
But like,
you don't strike me as a hoodie person. You're always very well put together. Oh, with you're always make an effort, unlike
but
me.
I just remember every time I see those things, I'm like, oh, that's it.
Do you know what they're called? The little
no.
things in the end. So they're the same thing as the end of shoelaces, and they have a name.
What is
aglets?
Aglets?
They're called aglets.
It
yeah.
sounds like something a Boston person says when they're trying to say something else.
But I'm driving, a bunch of fucking aglets pull in front
yeah,
of me.
Yeah.
And I'm like, this isn't your fucking part of the city.
Yeah.
Go back to Aggie Town.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, that sounds right. Yeah, but no, they're really called that, aglets. The little plastic thing at the end of shoelaces are called aglets. I normally would watch The X-Files. But 99, this is a repeat because we're in the summer, so I would have already seen this one. It's a guest starring role by Bruce Campbell, which is amazing.
Okay.
But because it's a rerun, I'm going with another documentary, Behind the Music, Donna Summer, Speaking of Boston.
Donna Summer's from Boston?
From Dorchester. Yeah, absolutely.
I did not know that.
Yeah, so it's first of all, it's Donna Summer. Second of all, it's Boston, and it'll be Boston in the 70s.
Yeah.
Totally watching that.
All right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that seems like an interesting...
Yeah.
Her story now seems much more interesting to me.
Oh, she's a fascinating person. Yeah.
She
grew up in a really rough part of Dorchester, still lived there, even when she was super famous, like, and had a house there, gave a lot of money back to the community.
Oh, nice.
That's why they do that Donna Summer roller disco party at City Hall Plaza every year.
Oh, I didn't know. That's an interesting choice to just decide to do
Donna
that.
Donna Summer, of all things. Yeah, yeah, because she's from here.
Nice. Yeah, yeah. All right. Very cool.
Unlike New Kids on the Block, who were from West Roxbury. Well, the Wahlbergs from Dorchester. Monday night, 8 o'clock, what are you going with?
That 70s Show, two episodes back to back.
So, sometimes I think the show's funny, sometimes I hate it.
Oh, that's legitimate. That's 100%
Even
legitimate.
A fan would say that.
Yeah, yeah. Sometimes these episodes suck. The characters, Mila Kunis isn't even a real character. She's just a whiny, like, noise in the background all the time.
Yeah. 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 And then it had that problem, too, with shows that went on too long where they didn't have enough characters, so at some point everybody's dating each other.
Yes.
And then it got like...
I was talking to somebody about this because we were talking about Friends, actually, and it's like, when that happens, when everyone dates everyone, usually it just stops being a friend group. Like,
yeah,
you don't hang out after that.
It's not interesting anymore. Yeah. And like, I feel like if they could get away with it, they would have the siblings date each other just to have a plot line. This one is a girl planning to start a punk band invites Hyde to accompany her to New York City.
Oh.
So this might have been when that 80s show was starting.
I remember that. That was so bad.
It was really bad.
That was really, really bad.
But Margaret Smith was in it, who's a stand-up that I really like.
Oh, is she?
She's really like this, really low-key. Huh. And she was a really funny stand-up. And then that was the last thing I remember seeing her in, but she was like the record store owner on that
show.
So I don't know if I would have watched that. There is an expose on a thing called Outside the Lines. It's a news magazine program.
Okay.
And it's about high school jock culture. And it's hosted by Shelley Smith. High school jock culture, and jock is in quotes, intentions between athletes and non-athletes are examined in the wake of the April 20 shootings at Columbine High School.
Fuck.
We went all over the country and talked to students, teachers, principals, parents, psychologists, and sociologists. We wanted to peel back the layers and find out what's really going on between athletes and non-athletes.
That's such an 80s, like, dichotomy. Like, I feel like that's definitely, like, a Revenge of the Nerds dichotomy between the jocks and the not jocks versus, like, there were so many more groups in the late 90s versus just, like, jocks and not jocks.
That is a weird distillation. I mean, I do remember, I forgot that Columbine was that year.
Yeah.
And I remember seeing it happen. And I forgot that in the wake of that, that was kind of the discussion. It wasn't gun control.
It was
jocks versus goths, man.
I was like, there were goths, there were like preppy kids, like there were so many more distinct groups.
There was more little cliques. It wasn't necessarily, because like the jocky kids in my high school were usually the complete fuck-ups and cokeheads.
Yeah.
A lot of them were coke dealers. This is in the suburbs of Boston.
Okay.
In the 90s.
Nice.
But it was that kind of thing, you know?
Yeah.
And this, the most amazing thing here is that they have a little bit of advice for how we could solve this problem. We found that if you can get kids to cross over, like get the athletes to sing in the school musical, then there's less tension.
That's fucking dumb. They met young people?
Yeah.
Shut up.
That's what they said.
Your ideas are, come on, shut up.
But I'm very intrigued by that. I definitely would watch that.
You know, we're also going to solve racism.
Get the white kids to rap.
Hang out. Yeah.
Everything that'll understand. Fix it. Yeah. It'll fix it. We thought Vanilla Ice was going to solve everything.
Yeah, it's, oh my God, that's...
Yeah, that seems very, very simplistic.
Yeah.
And then the 8:30 episode of that 70s show is Eric's new lab partner has money, a cool car, and most of Eric's attention, which irritates his other friends.
Oh.
But then this is really interesting. You can chat with Laura Prepron of that 70s show at www.tvguide.com on June 21st at 7 p.m. It must have been like a Ask Me Anything kind of web chat room thing, which seems, again, 99 seems kind of weirdly early for that.
Yeah,
I'm actually surprised by that. 9 o'clock, would you go with?
This is Monday. Ally McBeal, 100%.
So this is a show that was enormous.
I watched, I think, every episode. Like, my mom was into it. We all watched it.
Nobody talks about it now.
No.
It's completely forgotten.
No.
It was the biggest show.
It's how we all got the joy that is Lucy Liu.
That's true.
Yeah.
And it's what brought back Robert Downey Jr.
Oh, yeah.
That is what his comeback came from.
Oh.
I think people so only dreamy. Think of the Dancing Baby.
Dancing Baby. Because they had, like, weird... I do like that. And I liked to see... Because my mom watched... All My Children, the soap opera that is no longer on.
Oh, I'm familiar.
Yes. She watched that every day. Like, she saw every single episode from when she was a child to when it eventually went off the air. And they would try to pull in elements because Ally McBeal was so popular. And they would have these, like, weird dream sequences or, like, this is what I was thinking when something else was happening. So, like, they tried to pull it into this soap opera. And it was very bad. But that's how big it was.
It was huge. It was huge. And Calista Flockhart was enormous. And they were like, she's going to be a big movie star.
She is not.
No. I don't even think she's been in anything in
years. I think if she ate a sandwich.
That was the big thing. She was very thin.
Like paint, like bird. Yeah.
Like she looked frail.
Yes.
Yeah. And I couldn't. She was. And I haven't rewatched this show, and I did like David E. Kelly's dialogue. It was David E. Kelly, right?
Yeah.
But she was almost not a character. She was just like a facial expression.
Yeah.
She was just kind of there to go like, ooh, yeah. And that was it. And, you know, maybe I'll revisit that show. Have you tried to rewatch it?
I have not tried to rewatch it since, but
I haven't either.
David E. Kelly made like a bunch of shows also set in Boston.
Oh, yeah.
And I watched
He's from here.
All of them.
Yeah.
Like
Boston Legal, yep. Boston Public, I think.
Yep.
Was him
oh,
too.
Boston Public. Yeah. Ooh, that was salacious. Loved it.
This one is Ling turns to the firm when a local group threatens to shut down her mud wrestling club. Meanwhile, Allie develops an interest in the opposing counsel who once dated Georgina.
Ooh.
Mud wrestling.
Yeah. You know, pretty ladies, you gotta have them do something to, you know.
Rachel and I used to do this thing, don't worry. if we're driving.
Yeah.
And we drive by an adult business. Mm-hmm. She'd pull it up on her phone and read the Yelp reviews.
Nice.
Because they all have Yelp reviews.
Of course they do.
And there was one in New Hampshire that this place is near a comic book store. And it's called something like Lusty Lace or something. But it's just this big sign that says, totally nude ladies. And she was reading the Yelp reviews. And it turned into this epic story about how they did illegal mud wrestling there and then it got shut down and then she found all these court documents and then how they'd switched the mud to something else and then
what?
They had mud. It was the most fascinating story I've heard in a long time. Yeah,
all about mud wrestling, yeah. With this establishment.
And we just found that with our fine car game.
Nice.
Yelp
that seems
reviews
like a
of
fun,
adult businesses.
I yeah. feel like all the listeners should also do that.
It's really fun. Yeah. If you ever drive by a weird place
right.
That you don't want to go into, but
yeah.
You can read the Yelp reviews, and they're fantastic.
I'm yeah. on it.
Because who writes a Yelp review
yeah.
of like
publicizing
kittens.
That they were there yeah,
yeah. And like this one like the shots girl's a little too pushy, like it's all it's just like a Yelp review for anything
yes.
else you've read but about booby bars. Yeah, fantastic.
That's ridiculous. I would
wrestling.
Love to read those.
Yeah, mud wrestling. Oh boy. I'm at 9 o'clock. I'm going again with Behind the Music.
Wow.
They're doing a marathon all week on VH1, and this is Behind the Music Studio 54.
Ooh,
so it might be disco week,
yeah.
Or I think that movie 54 came out around this time
with Ryan Felipe and
yep.
Nev Campbell.
Yes,
Nev Campbell. Yeah,
Nev Campbell and Mike Myers.
Really?
As the owner of Club 54, it was a dramatic role for him.
Yeah,
and people were like, he's gonna get drummer roles now. He's gonna get nominated for an Oscar.
That's not.
He's good in it, but he didn't.
That's not.
No,
yeah.
It never happened. Mm-hmm. He's in movies with Calista Flockhart now. Tuesday night, 8 o'clock. What'd you go with?
Third Rock from the Sun. Loved it. Joseph Gordon-Levitt. I met him. I didn't meet him. I saw him at a taco place in LA once, but I saw him first in Angels in the Outfield, and I was like, I'm gonna follow this kid's career forever.
I saw him in the remake of Dark Shadows. In 1990, he was in the Dark Shadows remake.
Okay.
Yeah, as a very young kid. I couldn't get into this show.
Really?
Yeah,
it's so good.
It was just so silly.
John Lithgow?
I like John Lithgow. Have you seen Buckaroo Banzai?
No.
Oh, you got to see Buckaroo Banzai. If you like John Lithgow,
I do like John
being
Lithgow.
Crazy, it's the most out of control John Lithgow I've ever seen in my life.
I'm into it.
He plays a, speaking of Nazis, he plays an extra dimensional fascist. Like alien fascist.
Okay.
Named Dr. Lizardo.
Lizardo, yeah. Okay.
Lithgow. It's Lithgow.
Lithgow.
My wife just
oh.
felt the need to correct us because she's spoken to him on the phone before.
Oh, okay.
And he has emphasized that it's Lithgow.
Lithgow.
Lithgow, yes.
Got it.
Maybe if he'd only made Harry and the Hendersons, he'd be Lithgow.
Okay.
But since he's made Cliffhanger,
yes.
He is Lithgow.
Okay, Lithgow.
But I think the show is so goofy,
mm-hmm.
I just couldn't, and I love Jean Curtin. And I felt like her character didn't get enough to do.
Hmm.
I don't know. I was 19.
Which one's Jane Curtin? She's like the big lady?
No, no. That, I forget her name. Jane Curtin was like Dick's sort of love interest.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
I loved her frustration all of the time.
Yeah.
It was great. Yeah.
She was an original SNL cast member and was on Kate and Ally. She's from Boston, grew up in Cambridge.
Nice.
Went to Northeastern.
Oh.
But I love her, and she just didn't get used in a way that I enjoyed on that show.
Uh-huh.
But this episode is The Big Giant Head grants Sally's 3-year-old request for a gender reassignment and switches her body with Dick's.
Yes.
Yeah. Dick is the name of one of the characters.
Yes.
He doesn't just turn her into dicks.
Just one big dick.
Yeah, you're... No, just now dick, you're, plural.
Oh,
you're a,
dick.
You're a whole like bunch of dicks.
Like, they're not even, like, attached to one another. It's just a loose
pile.
Just
a pile of dicks.
Yeah.
It looks like a pile of shoes.
She's gotta, like, lead the group from that. Yeah.
You ever go to a bowling alley at closing time, and they stack all the shoes up to spray that stuff in them?
Just that.
Like that for dicks. Yeah. Yep, they're gonna put them away at the end of the night. No, this is a character named Dick. I was played by John Lithgow. Mm. Not a pile of dicks, everybody. I'm going with Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Oh,
that
yeah.
This is Buffy and a slayer named Faith. This is the introduction of Eliza Dushku to the show.
Oh, yeah.
From Watertown, Mass.
Oh, is she?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. That makes sense because she was at the studio at some point for something.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
She still lives in Watertown. She's going back to school. I think she's going to Suffolk.
What?
For like some, she wants some degree. I don't know what it is.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, so she's still
like,
around.
You were in Bring It On. Like, what? You don't need to do anything else.
Yeah. Well, you'd be surprised how much money that you don't get paid for this
movie. Bring It On was like a cultural touchstone.
Yeah. And this is a vampire with a fatal plan for the lady. So this is her a repeat of her introduction to the show.
Got it.
So I'm totally watching that. What'd you go with? The Era from the Sun and then 8:30. Did you do
News Radio?
Love News Radio.
It's so good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One of the most underrated shows in the 90s.
Right? I'm a big fan of the relationship dynamic before they get together of the like the woman who thinks she's gonna be the head person and then the guy
Dave and what's her real name McTaggart Tierney who's from West Roxbury.
Oh huh.
Yeah, there's a whole plot in a News Radio episode where she has a Boston accent they kept saying and she's like I don't and they kept because their character is also supposed to be from
all
Boston.
Right.
Yeah,
I'll check that out.
Yeah, it's very funny. But this is before Phil Hartman died.
Yeah.
Just a great show. One of the best workplace sitcoms ever.
It was really good.
And it's still funny. Like, I will rewatch it now, and it's so funny.
Yeah.
Stephen Root, so funny.
Wait, who's Stephen Root?
He's the boss.
Is he the stapler guy?
Yeah. He's also Milton in Office Space.
Okay.
Yeah. But, like, Andy Dick's really funny. Joe Rogan's really funny. In it. Everyone's great in that show.
It's really good.
Yeah, I love that show. And then 9 o'clock, what'd you go with?
9 o'clock, Spin City. I think.
That's another one of my favorite 90s shows.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Please tell me it's still with Michael J. Fox?
It is still with Michael J. Fox.
Okay, cool. Because they switched it to Charlie Sheen, which was a mistake.
Yeah.
That was, I wasn't into it after that. But Michael J. Fox, without a doubt, the first person who I was like, I am marrying that person.
Yeah.
I know this for a fact. I watched Back to the Future as a child. I had to be like 6 years old. But I was still like, nope, I'm pretty settled. For the rest of my life.
Seems like a good guy.
Yeah. This is the person I'm going to be with.
I've never heard a bad story about him either.
Yeah.
Like, I did an episode with Emmanuel Lewis, and they used to shoot on the same lot, and Manny, as it used to be called, couldn't really go anywhere.
Yeah.
And Michael J. Fox used to take him out to lunch in his car, and they'd, like, hang out.
Nice.
And it was just like, he was just nice to everybody, which he had no need to be.
Of course he was.
He is Canadian.
Fucking course he was.
Have you ever seen Midnight Madness?
No.
It's the first movie he was ever in. It's the first Disney PG-rated movie. It's about a scavenger hunt in Los Angeles. It's from 1980.
Super fun,
weird movie.
Okay.
Has a set of twins in it.
I'm pro that.
They're really overweight.
Okay.
There is a scene where they disco dance. But Michael J. Fox is playing a 12-year-old in it.
How old is he?
He's probably like 15.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. But it's really good Michael J. Fox action. This is a great episode.
Heart a flutter.
Yeah. I agree. Amid plans for the holidays, Stuart's sexual orientation comes into question, and Mike matches wits with a chess-playing chimp.
That doesn't sound like the best episode
this
of this
show. This is a funny episode. This is because Carter is gay on the show.
Wait, which one's Carter?
Carter is the black guy.
Yes.
And he's a really great character.
Yes.
And Stuart, who's Alan Ruck, who was Cameron in Ferris Bueller.
I love him so much.
They're like kind of best friends, even though they're adversaries.
Yes.
So Carter keeps being like, yeah, you're gay. And he's and he gets very confused. Yeah, it's fantastic.
Just you describing this makes me very happy. And I want to see this episode again.
It's great. Oh. And Carter had that dog that wanted to die all the time. Do you remember he had that hideous dog that looks like Jenny Zagrino's dog? Hi, Jenny. and it was this super old dog that he inherited from his parents when they died. And the dog just looked so sickly. And there's a scene where, there was like a running joke that the thing kept trying to kill itself.
Yeah.
And at one point, Stuart's there with the dog alone, and the dog looks at him and just goes, "Kill me." It's like, it's really funny.
This is a show I really want to revisit.
I love that
show. I think it was super solid. I think it was great 90s stuff. That was Heather Locklear.
She came in later.
Later,
yeah.
Okay.
So it started as Carla Cugino, was the first girlfriend.
Okay.
And then it was
Paula Marshall.
Marshall.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
She came in before Heather Locklear.
Okay. This is super in-group versus out-group. I always root more for a brunette lady to get the guy than the blonde lady.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah. I like Heather Locklear, but she was, it's Heather Locklear.
Yeah. It's like, huh.
She doesn't need it, you know? Yeah. Not that Paula Marshall and like, Carla Gugino aren't like stunning women.
Yeah.
But yeah, it seemed like a better fit.
Yes.
Between Mike and one of them.
Yeah.
Love that show. The X Games are also on.
Oh, I used to really like the X Games. Like, I never did anything. Like, I never skateboarded or anything, but I was, like, super into watching. And I'd say, like, sick, like, a
this
lot.
This is X. Yeah. This is bicycle stunt competition from Louisville and Richmond.
When they do, like, the flips in the air over the hills. Oh, I fucking loved that. That was the best.
Did you play any sports? Did you do any kind
of... I did gymnastics.
Oh, okay.
And so my mom kind of had me on this, like... weird thing where it's like you always have to do a sport, but it's the sport of your choosing, and it can be whatever kind of fucking sport you want. So I did, over the course of my childhood and into high school, I did figure skating, I did gymnastics, I did dance, I did ballroom dancing, I did horseback riding.
All individual sports.
Yeah, all individual sports.
Well, not horseback riding or ballroom dancing.
Kind of.
Or horseback ballroom. Let's make a movie called Horseback Ballroom.
Like the grace and beauty. Yeah.
That would be, I would watch that any day. We could sell that to Disney.
Let's do it.
Pixar would make a horseback ballroom.
Oh, fucking,
movie.
Yeah, they would.
Man, yeah. We just made so
a horse
much money.
Just like constantly being told, you can't ballroom dance, and then like showing everybody.
Or he's like a mule.
Oh, yeah, because mules are more classically ungraceful. Well, these majestic horses, and he's got to
like
come in and
prove it.
It's like
Arabians and Clydesdales.
Yeah, and he comes in, he's a mule, and he shows them.
Yeah, he does the best ballroom dancing. And it'll be like they shoot horses, don't they? They Shoot Horses, Don't They? Is based on a book, and it's about a dance competition in the 60s where they just keep dancing and dancing and dancing. Yeah.
Do people drop dead in that or something?
I don't remember. I think it's like
was Jane Fonda in that?
Yes, I think so. Yeah. So it'll kind of be like a sly reference to that. Because the horses are dancing.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we can license Echo and the Bunnymen song, Bring on the Dancing Horses.
Ooh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Perfect. I think
we just made so much money.
We
like,
did.
I might
guys
just
don't
buy.
Sell this idea.
Yeah,
this is
that's
us.
Time stamped.
Yeah.
But yeah. So what was your favorite of those?
Probably I did gymnastics for 7 years, so probably gymnastics because they were like, you're okay, but you got the body, like, because I'm very short and I have like
you're a tiny person.
Yeah, I'm like tiny and I've always had super strong like. Whatever, I have strong thighs. It's fine. So yeah, they were like,
I once saw her kill a man like Famke Jensen. And
yes. I probably could. I don't know. I haven't done it. Don't worry about it.
Don't heckle at her shows.
Don't. I will leap over these tables and I will put you on the ground.
And you're already on the stage, so you have an advantage.
It's pretty dope. So they were like, So I just kept doing that. So it was nice. Yeah.
What did you have like a thing you specialized in, like the pummel horse?
I liked the this doesn't really involve thigh strength at all. I liked the bars.
Okay.
Yeah.
I like that you said the phrase that doesn't involve thigh strength at all, and it was an appropriate phrase to use for what followed that sentence.
Yes.
The bars. Yeah. I'd hang out in the bars. You know how it is. And then at 9:30, what'd you go with?
Sportsnight. Come on.
I never watched it.
What?
Everybody loved it.
Come on.
I think because of the word sports in it.
I know.
Like,
I don't like team sports,
it,
really, but as far as workplace things, I really think you should give that one a shot.
I need to revisit that show.
Yeah.
I think it's streaming, so I'll revisit
it. Yeah, I mean, it's got a pretty strong fan base.
Oh, good pedigree, good cast.
Yes.
But I just never, I missed it when it aired and then just never. It was one of those shows that I remember, like, in the early days of DVD, or, like, when a lot of people had adopted DVD, it was Sports Night and Mr. Show. Kids, like, just were discovering because of the DVDs.
Mm-hmm.
And I had been watching Mr. Show since it started.
Right.
But then people were like, Sports Night, Sports Night. And I just didn't, for whatever reason, I was like, no, because I'm contrarian and used to be a lot worse. Wednesday, 8 o'clock, what are you going with?
Dawson's Creek, 100%.
For the North Carolina Pride?
For the North Carolina Pride, because I was super into what happened between, like, Joey, Pacey. Michelle Williams was on there. She had complications. Her friend killed herself. Like, it was so interesting.
This is Mr. McPhee returns amid rampant rumors about Jack's sexuality.
Oh, yeah,
Jack.
Which
continues to haunt Joey.
Yeah, okay.
Someone told me I looked like that kid once, and it really freaked me out.
Brendan Fair?
Is he the gay kid?
I think so.
Yeah.
He was also in a U2 music video for Stuck in a Moment That You Can't Get It and You Can't Get
It. He was
in
that movie, The Forgotten. Not The Forgotten? It was like a vampire movie that he was in.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Was he?
No, I think his last name's Kerr.
Kerr, okay.
Or his first name's Kerr.
Kerr Smith?
Kerr Smith, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I'm thinking of a different person.
Was there more than one gay person on that show? Maybe. Was that allowed in 1999?
I think, well, no, he met somebody he was interested in, and I, for some reason, I'm mentally pairing that with Kerr Smith. Yeah, you look more like. I was like,
Winner is a black guy.
Yeah, that's so funny. Yeah. Okay. I think I'm conflating that guy because maybe he was also in Roswell. Did you ever watch that show?
Yeah, Roswell, which had Jason Ritter. John Ritter's son. Was
yes. In it. And fucking Katherine Heigl.
Yes. Yes. Yep. After Getting Even with Dad, in which she starred with Gerard Depardieu.
Interesting.
Yes.
Was it a French movie or just a weird-ass American movie?
It was a weird-ass American movie. Right. It was when they were trying to make Gerard Depardieu an American actor.
Nope.
After he did Green Card with Andy McDowell.
Boo.
And so this one was, Katherine Heigl was like a bitchy 13-year-old, and her dad was always trying to hang out with her. And he was embarrassing because he was Gerard Depardieu. Ugh. And it was a terrible movie. Yeah, terrible.
Yeah, that doesn't sound
I never really got into Dawson's Creek. It just didn't do anything for me. There's not a lot on it this time. Touched by an Angel is on. So I think I'm going to go with A&E Biography, Annette Funicello.
Who is that?
Annette Funicello. I have a book right here that I'm pointing to. Yeah. That's an Annette book. Annette Funicello was the first sort of female teen idol. She was one of the original Mouseketeers. And when she grew up, she was just beloved. She was in all of the AIP beach party movies.
Okay.
She was the spokesperson for Skippy Peanut Butter in the 80s. Mm-hmm. She would show up in things all the time. And she was a huge megastar in the 50s and 60s. So she had a pretty fascinating life as well.
What's her last name?
Funicello.
She had a last name like that, like an ethnic last name like that?
Oh, that's Italian. She had a filthy WAP name and she still got on TV. Yeah. Well, her partner in all these movies was a guy named Frankie Avalon.
Oh, okay. You've seen in Greece.
I've heard of him. Yeah. He lives in the North End still.
Why?
He's an old guy. Yeah, but I own, let me see if I can see it. No, it's not in the room anymore. I actually, when Annette Funicello died, they auctioned off a lot of her belongings and I have a bunch of her stuff here, like promo stuff for movies, because she's in this movie called Back to the Beach, which is, I love this movie.
Okay.
And it was from 1989 and it was sort of a reunion of all the people that were in the beach movies in the 60s.
Ah, okay.
But like Pee Wee Herman's also in it and it's just like a fun, funny, weird movie.
Yeah.
And she had a cast pin that I have now.
All right.
With like a certificate of authenticity. I have Annette Funicello's cast pin. And I'm staring at her face right now.
Yeah.
So that's like when people would talk about the original Musketeers, they'd always be like, Annette. Yeah, and that's her. So I'm watching that.
All right. That makes sense. I get that.
And then you're not doing anything at 9:30 or at 8:30 because you're watching an hour of Dawson's Creek.
Yeah.
And then 9 o'clock, would you go with?
Charmed.
Love Charmed.
Did you?
It's a dumb show.
I love, but it's you get into it.
Yeah, yeah. We watched a marathon the other day.
Yeah.
Prue is hunted by a magical warrior who needs the powers of a witch in order to regain his own. So she casts a spell to triple her strength, but it results in two Prue clones. So Prue is Shannon Doherty?
Oh, yeah. Because this is before they replaced her
with Rose McGowan.
Yeah.
She's been on the show.
Very yep. Was she nice? I don't know.
I've had her on this show.
Okay,
yeah,
cool. Yeah. Oh man.
Yeah.
That was when like Wiccan shit came like real popular.
Yeah. Blair Witch was like that year. Charmed was sort of, they were like, Buffy's a little bit too smart.
Yeah.
So we need something like
melodramatic.
But that's a little more dramatic than Sabrina.
Yes.
Yeah. But watching the later seasons, like especially when Rose McGowan is in it, the girl who plays Piper does not give a shit about anything.
Oh, no.
Like, they're in dire peril, and she's like, yeah, whatever. I guess we'll do this. Yeah. Plus, I love Alyssa Milano. Who doesn't?
Yes. Oh, man. A lot of people had a lot of feelings for her.
They certainly did.
Yeah.
Yes. Much, much like your feelings for Michael J. Fox.
Yes.
For Alyssa Milano. Because many people watched her from Who's the Boss and watched her grow into a fine young lady.
She did.
I would normally watch that, but again, going with Behind the Music, it's 70s week. David Cassidy.
All right.
Yep, from the Partridge Family.
Yes.
David Cassidy. And his story got crazy, and I absolutely would have loved it.
What happened to him?
Well, he had no career, and then he had like a comeback, and then he didn't, and then he was huge in Japan, and it was just like a whole thing.
Weird.
And Sean Cassidy, his brother, who was in the Hardy Boys show in the 70s, became a producer, and he produces like tons of huge TV shows.
Wow. Yeah. All right. That's...
He's one of those people that discovered you want to go behind the scenes once you're old.
Yeah.
And people don't want to look at you anymore.
Right.
And then you make real money.
True.
Where are we? Thursday?
Thursday, yep.
8 o'clock.
Friends. All right.
You're a must-see TV.
I am to some extent. I rewatched every single episode of Friends last year because every year I try to watch 100 new things. And
yeah.
One thing can be like a season of TV or like a movie. Right. It's not a great conversion rate.
Yeah, because that's time-wise, you're not going to get a lot of things.
But I watched all 10 seasons of Friends. I think it is such a dumb show.
It's not funny.
It's not funny.
It's terrible.
The people on there are like, okay, these are like garbage. Like, these are not people you'd want to be friends with.
They're bad people.
Yes, they are. They're like, they'll make other people's lives more complicated. Instead of like fixing it or something, they'll just like walk away from shitty situations. Like, just, yeah. They don't, yeah, they're, I think they're all bad people.
I could recommend Super so many shows you should homophobic. Spend time watching other than that.
Yeah, like, Chandler's whole thing is that, I swear to God, I'm not gay. Like, that's his
I'm
entire.
Not gay.
Yeah, that's his character. Yeah. And I'm like, that's not good enough to be a character.
Both
like,
Matts are from Newton.
Really?
Yeah, Matthew Perry and Matt LeBlanc are both from Newton, Mass.
Why?
I don't know. That's where they grew up.
Yeah. I met Matthew. I met him once when, so at BU, if you do the BU in LA program, you'll get to go to different lots for different things. And one time our teacher was like, we had met with a VP at Sony Pictures Entertainment, and we were all supposed to go home, but he turned to like some of us who were like asking more questions and like being a little bit more active, and he leaned, it's like an old, like old guy, crazy gray hair, and he just leans in real close and he's like, "You're on the lot now. You can do whatever
you
want."
Yeah,
you
just walk around. Yeah,
yeah,
once you
just
get in
go
there.
Explore.
Yeah.
And so we're like, okay. So like we snuck into, he was doing some show, this is after Friends had gone off the air, where it had something to do with sports, and I think Allison Janney was in this show.
Yeah, it was Studio 60 on the Sunset Strip.
No, fudge. Something, like somebody was a manager of a sports team or something.
Oh, Sportsnight 2.
Yes.
I remember the show. I can't think of the name. You're talking about. Yeah.
Maybe Mr. No, Mr. Sunshine was in. They have tried to put him in so many shows.
Yeah. I don't find him likable.
He's not.
And he's been in shows since he was 16.
And they keep trying. Yeah.
He was in a Fox show in 87 called Second Chance when he was 15. That was one of the first shows he was on.
Yeah, people were like, why was it this collection of people to be in Friends? Yeah, it was, but we snuck around and we met this sound lady as we were eating from the craft services table. And she's like, "What are you guys doing here?" And we're students and we're exploring. And she's like, "Do you want to like come sit with us?" And
yeah. Like, check out, like learn something.
Yeah. So we learned about like sound recording, and then like she introduced us all to the director, and then Matthew Perry comes over and is like, "Hey, what's going on?"
This was bloated Matthew Perry.
Yes. Bloated. Yes.
Yeah.
Bloated. Still kind of getting off pills.
Yeah.
Drinking.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of people don't know that once you get on a lot, there's security, but like people are like, if you're here, we assume you got through something, so you have a reason. You could just go wherever you want.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm like, I have friends who work on lots now, and I'm like, if I'm in LA, I'm like, that's what I want to do.
Get me a drive on pass.
Yeah, I just want to.
And then you just walk around all day.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We went to, a friend works at Paramount, and she got us in a lot, and we went and met with the woman who her whole job is to go through the warehouses and find the jewelry, fix it, and then figure out what movie it was from, and then catalog it.
Wow.
So,
okay.
Because what they used to do was they would actually rent out all that stuff.
Uh-huh.
So you could, if you like were, I'm going to a Halloween party, I want to rent a Cleopatra outfit, you might have got the Cleopatra outfit from Cleopatra.
Yeah.
And so they stopped doing that.
Nice.
And part of it is they're inventorying it for like insurance reasons and assets and stuff. But it's a really cool job. So she's like a jeweler and a detective and goes through stills and matches
stuff
up.
That's really cool.
So she was like, "Oh, this is Rosemary Clooney's bracelet from White Christmas I just discovered."
Yeah.
And then she was also fixing all the jewelry from Coming to America. She had all,
all the
stuff.
Gold stuff?
Yeah. So we had
that's really cool.
It was really cool. And I'm like, this is just your job.
Yeah.
You're just hanging around doing this. That's great.
It's pretty awesome.
That is a fine pick for a bad show. I don't think I would watch Friends. I definitely wasn't watching it in 99.
Right.
This is a tough night. I was totally out of that must-see TV at this point. And I think I have to go with Biography again because it's one of my favorites. Elizabeth Montgomery from Bewitched.
Okay, good.
She's Samantha.
I know this name. Okay.
Yeah. I love her. A fascinating life story. She produced a show for a while. Like she, absolutely watching this. And she had just died that year.
Oh,
so
shit.
They probably just started this biography. So I'm totally on that for the hour.
Nice.
8:30, did you go with Jesse?
No, I went with TRL. Like the first 30 minutes
TRL.
Of TRL.
Okay.
Yeah.
I never watched TRL at that point.
I watched TRL a lot in middle school.
And this was when Carson Daly was hosting it. Yep. The kid who picked up hosting for him after. What the hell's his name?
He wore like bowling shirts and
sometimes,
stuff?
Yeah. He went to Northeastern with me. Brian McFadden?
Yeah, that sounds right.
Yes, yeah. He went to Northeastern with me as well. As well as the kid who invented Napster. We were all in the same class.
Sean something?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. I don't remember what his name is. That bastard. but yeah, so I couldn't, I mean, TRL, not my thing.
Yeah, but this is something that Emily Ruskowski and I have bonded over. Loved boy bands.
Yes.
When I was in middle school. Like, knew all of the words to everything.
Who was your favorite?
NSYNC, probably, but there were some hits that I think just like, Jordan Knight's Give It to You.
That's a good song.
It's a fucking great song, and it never, like, people never, like, I'm just a big fan of that song. Yeah.
I had Brett Anderson on the show, who was in the band The Donnas. And they were on TRL once, and her story about how weird it was is fascinating.
They only play like 30 seconds of your video.
They made it. They did a live performance on TRL.
Okay.
So they made them all stand on different platforms. It was very weird. If listeners haven't heard that episode, definitely go back and listen to it. The Brett one's really good.
All right.
But yeah, it was fascinating to hear from someone who was like on TRL, like what it was like, and it was probably around 99, 2000.
Yeah.
Very, very weird. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Recommended. I'm recommending my own show to you like a complete jerk.
No.
9 o'clock, I think I'm going to go with Jonathan Creek, which is a British show that stars Alan Davies, who's a British stand-up comedian. Who's on? Have you ever seen QI with Stephen Fry? He's one of the team captains. Curly hair.
Yes.
So he plays a stage magician who solves murders.
So that sounds so dorky.
Oh, yeah.
I like it.
It's British.
So
and this one is an obnoxious theater critic is the victim of an art theft. Jonathan can easily solve the crime, but he's still stinging from a bad review of his magic show.
I like it, but I also like deep down, like, fucking nerd.
Oh, yeah. It's super nerd. When I went to school in England, all my friends were super into Jonathan Creek, so I started watching it there. But I probably would have watched it, because it's Leif Garrett behind the music at 9, and that's the one where the guy you put in a wheelchair confronts him. And it's just awkward.
Yeah.
So I'm definitely going Jonathan Creek.
All right.
Yep.
I put Frasier.
I couldn't get into it.
Really?
I love Cheers, hate Frasier.
I like Frasier.
Yeah, a lot of people do. I don't think you're alone there.
It's my pretentiousness.
I just don't. Yeah, I didn't like any of the characters on it.
Even
just,
the English lady?
No. No. She was a Benny Hill girl.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I just couldn't. I tried. Couldn't get into it.
It's not for everybody, but I was into it.
And then 9:30, what'd you do?
Will and Grace.
So you didn't go to the PJs.
No.
Which is a bad show.
Yeah.
It was Eddie Murphy's claymation show.
Nope.
This one is when Thurgood is slammed with complaints from the tenants about his building, he seeks aid from HUD. That sounds boring.
Yeah.
Will and Grace's Will encourages Grace to find a place of her own, but discourages her from the suggestion that she move in with him.
Huh.
I thought they lived together.
Did they?
Maybe they didn't. They're just good friends.
Yeah.
I never watched it.
Yeah.
Remember my high school girlfriend, everyone told her she reminded them of the Megan Mullally character.
Karen, yeah.
Which was, she didn't like.
She didn't like it? Okay. So, you know Caitlin Durante?
Yeah.
When I first met her, I was like, you look like a young Megan Mullally. And then she was like,
I could see that.
Right? She was like, that is so weird of you to say, and that's not anywhere near accurate. And I was like, look at yourself.
Yeah.
Look at Megan Mullally.
Megan Mullally is a pretty lady.
She
is.
That's
not an insult.
She's like, I don't aspire to be Megan Mullally, but like, as far as like aging well and like just like looking good and being like, this is me and taking charge of it. Like, I respect that so much about Mullally. Yeah.
That Caitlin's a weirdo.
Yeah. She knows she's a weirdo. Like,
she does. Yeah. She kind of embraces it. She plays it up. I think it's an act. She's really not that weird.
She's kind of weird.
She's a little weird.
In
another reference to, this is like in Marvel Comics when they'd reference an old comic and there'd be an asterisk and it would tell you what episode, what comic.
Yeah.
But when Caitlin did the show, she told a story about how her father went, she went and got a pig's head from a butcher for a science project because she needed teeth.
Yeah.
And her father spent all night pulling the teeth out of this head for her with pliers.
I can see that.
Yeah. And I was like, okay, you grew up in rural Pennsylvania.
Yep.
Final night of the week.
Final night of the week.
Friday night. 8 o'clock.
8 o'clock. There didn't seem like much I really wanted to watch, so I went with World's Funniest, I think it's videos or something.
This is, where are we here? World's Funniest. That's just what
just
it's
world's
called.
World's Funniest, okay.
And this is the behavior of children, including a baby's first steps, a little boy who puts clothespins on his nose, and a girl who corners her sweetheart. for a kiss.
I do like watching kids do like just weird shit.
Yeah, no, kids are hilarious. Yeah. And I do love, and the show that I would pick actually is Kids Say the Darndest Things.
All right.
Which is hosted by Bill Cosby, who is a monster, but this is a remake of the Art Linkletter show from the 50s. And it is just kids saying crazy stuff because kids are insane and say bizarre things, and it's always funny.
It's great.
And this is a kid performs a commercial for a yucky soda drink, and youngsters react to host Bill Cosby's sneezing attack.
Okay.
But there used to be a show called, I think it was called Child's Play. And it's a game show.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know why they haven't brought this back, because it's a really funny concept. It was late 70s, early 80s. And they'd have a video of kids describing something.
Yeah.
You have to guess what it is.
I love that.
And they don't tell the kid what it is. So the kid, sometimes the kid's just completely out of left field.
Yeah.
And it's a really funny show. And it's a hard game.
Right.
Because you don't know what the hell they're talking about. Yeah. It's a really fun game show. It's on Buzzer sometimes now, which is like an over-the-air game show channel.
Mm-hmm.
And I highly recommend Child's Play if you see it on. Yeah.
I feel like parents should like just play that with their children just to like get an idea of like, all right, like say something bad's happened, or just like anything. Yeah. Like, okay, you don't know anything, and your basis for language is super weird. So, like, let's practice communicating.
Explain things to me.
Yeah.
And they'll say crazy things.
Yeah.
And that's why you have children.
To hear them say crazy things.
Exactly. Then would you go with, would you go till 9?
No, I went to 8:30. I'll flip in the middle of something. I don't care. Boy Meets World.
By this point, it was a bad show.
Yes.
This is when they were all living together. It was like a Friends ripoff.
But come on, like, Ryder Strong was so cute.
Yeah, but what weird name.
It is a weird name. It's a very weird name for a child to have.
This is they're rerunning the Christmas episode.
Okay.
And this one, Eric, working as Santa Claus, gets wrapped up in the spirit of giving, and Sean and Angela spend the holidays together with the Matthews.
I was so... Okay, so there would be a token black character on a lot of shows, but it wasn't often that they were dating one of the main people in the show.
Oh, sometimes. Is that what happened at this point?
So Angela and Sean are together.
Oh, they had a little interracial
thing. Yes, yes.
That was not a controversy. I'm kind of impressed by that.
Yeah, so I always liked that because I was like, he is dating a black girl.
Yeah.
I am a black girl.
I could date Michael J. Fox.
Yes. So it's cool now. Great. Yeah. I was super into that.
That I had stopped. I only watched like the first season or second season of that show, so I'd stopped watching it. But that is an interesting point. But I think I'm going with KABLAAM.
What is KABLAAM?
KABLAAM was on Nickelodeon, and it was a really weird. It was almost like MTV's Liquid Television, but it was like they have this thing called Super Action Force Now that were like these
action figures.
It was almost like Robot Chicken.
Yeah.
And it was like weird experimental cartoons and just a really bizarre show that was like pretty hip and like ahead of its time and was a weird show.
Uh-huh.
And at 19, I would definitely still watch it on Nickelodeon. All right. I'm going KABLAAM.
I'm impressed that that exists.
9 o'clock? What'd you do?
Sabrina the Teenage Witch.
Okay.
Also not good at this point.
No. Well, Sabrina was hit or miss. Also a Christmas episode. This is Sabrina rethinks her Grinch-like view of the holidays after she accidentally wipes everyone's memory of Christmas. I'm torn between two things here.
Okay.
There was a remake of The Love Boat that started this year in 1999. It was called Love Boat the Next Wave. This particular episode, an elf doll, voiced by Paul Fusco, who was Alf, comes to life for Nicole's niece, who has been traumatized by her parents' death.
What?
Yeah. An elf doll comes to life because a kid's parents died. And she's on a boat.
Why is she on this boat?
I don't know. Because do we send kids whose parents are dead on cruises?
I guess.
And an elf doll in 99? Like a weird elf cameo? No one else?
Who's taking care of her?
I don't know, but I'm intrigued. I want to watch that now. So I'm torn between that or Unsolved Mysteries. And Unsolved Mysteries that night is segments on the murder of three police officers during a Colorado shooting spree and reports of a Bigfoot-like creature in the Florida Everglades.
I could not watch Unsolved Mysteries as a kid because
it's terrifying.
Yeah, it was like, hey, a bunch of people got killed and the murder still out there, so good fucking luck. Like, what? Why did you tell me?
And a ton of them were in Massachusetts or New Hampshire, so that really freaked me out.
Not as many were in North Carolina, which makes me feel a little bit better.
No, but I feel like North Carolina had like a lot of serial killers or murders. Is there a lot of murders down there?
I don't know. I think there's like the regular amount of murders.
All right, your story checks out. You're not a murderer.
That you know.
This is my trap to see if you're a murderer. This is the regular amount of murders in North Carolina.
Just like,
So as you know, TV Guide is not just informative. It has opinions, and it cheers and it jeers. And I will read you the cheers and jeers for this week in 1999. It's a cheer-heavy week, so that's good news. But first, I want to ask you, are you trying to watch 100 new things this year?
Yes. Every year.
What's like something that has been a huge surprise that you really enjoyed that you watched recently?
I didn't think... So I was trying to go see like 20th Century Women or something, but I ended up seeing Manchester by the Sea, and I didn't want to. I was like, oh, sad people in Massachusetts can just walk. I can go to a fucking Dunkin' Donuts.
I have a show in Manchester tonight.
Yeah, like it was like, why would I do that? But I heard on a podcast that it was a dark comedy, and to go into it and view it from that lens, and viewing it from that lens. It's fucking great.
Well, everything is, if you look at it as a dark comedy.
Yeah. I was like, And I tried to describe that to people at a party this week, and they all called me a monster. They were like, you're a bad person.
So that sounds right. Yeah. And now I have to go see that.
Yeah.
So we start with a cheer.
Okay.
To the queen of cameos, Nancy O'Dell, the Access Hollywood anchor showed up on the series finale of Melrose Place as a witness to an attempted murder, and the same week showed up as a weathercaster on Charmed.
Whoa.
It would have been a quick cameo, except in the episode's Groundhog Day plot, O'Dell's brief stint was repeated over and over. Hey, come to think of it, we've also seen O'Dell recently on Beverly Hills 90210 and Sunset Beach. All of these shows are produced by Aaron Spelling. Don't tell Tori. I didn't say that was written in there.
Yeah, that was... Well, that's a way to say those things.
So you agree with that? I guess it's good that she's getting some acting gigs. This one, cheers to a Twilight twist. On the season finale of NBC's Third Rock from the Sun, William Shatner, playing the Supreme Commander of our merry band of visiting extraterrestrials, debarked from a plane, drunk and disheveled. A fawning dick asked him how his flight had been. Horrifying, said Shatner. I looked out the window and I saw something on the wing of the plane, which is a reference to the Twilight Zone.
Yes.
And the interesting thing is that in the Twilight Zone, the movie, John Lithgow plays that same character.
Yes, I remember that movie.
Seeing this and being really impressed that they had the double reference there.
Ah, that's pretty dope.
Yeah.
I'm pro that.
Yeah, I couldn't be anything but pro that.
Yeah.
Our only jeer of the week. Jeers to throwing up air balls. NBC's slap-happy announcing team of Tom Hammond, Bill Walton, and Steve Jones has us watching the NBA playoffs with the set muted. The trio seems to be interested in joshing, how 99 is that, jiving and jocularity than in providing information or analysis. While shots were being taken and rebounds grabbed, these stooges were busily teasing Jones for his lack of defense prowess while a student at University of Oregon. Guys, this is a basketball game, not an open mic at a local comedy club. We much preferred the playoff commentary provided by TNT's ad hoc team of Hubie Brown, Doc Rivers, and Karen Harlan, of NBC's affiliate announcers Bob Costas and Doug Collins.
I mean, I'll go Bob Costas all day every day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't want sports guys trying to make jokes.
Yeah.
It's never good.
I can take it occasionally, but if it's literally distracting from the game that I tuned in to watch, then I'm not interested.
Have you ever heard the having a taco incident?
No.
Oh, God. There was like a NASCAR race. And one of the guys is named Martinez or something.
Uh-huh.
And he was behind in the race. And the guy goes, where's Martinez? And the other announcer goes, he's having a taco. And then the other guy goes, And then he came back on and they fired the guy like immediately. And the other guy had to come back to the commercial and be like, we do not endorse the comments by. But it's so funny because he's so excited to make that joke.
Yeah.
And then it's like midway through the I think he realizes it's wrong. But he still has to like kind of follow through. He's having a taco. Yeah. That's one of my favorite.
I love how
moments.
That is something that our president would 100% say right now.
Like, oh, absolutely.
Or like that guy got fired immediately.
Yeah.
For the because
like
that's not
on the
acceptable.
Air.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But this guy's like, I'll just say that and
we'll vote for president. It's fine.
Yeah.
And finally, cheers to a mash note. In England, a mutual fund manager, Peter Young, charged with 5 counts of criminal fraud, has been showing up for court appearances adorned in heels, a wig, makeup, and a colorful frock. Observers assume that Young is laying the groundwork for a claim of unusual mental and emotional stress. Of course, the British tabloids have been having a field day with the case, dubbing Young's ingenious strategy the Klinger defense, in honor of our favorite cross-testing corporal, Jamie Farr. Must be so proud. I do not remember that, but that is amazing. Yeah. I need to follow up and see what happened to this
guy.
Yeah,
what happened? Yeah.
That, if we could write that as a script, we would get on the blacklist and we would win an Oscar next year.
Yeah.
We need to, Peter Young, if you haven't
Peter
sold the rights
Young.
To your story yet,
okay.
A mutual fund manager in England in 99.
Perfect.
Yeah, we got to make this movie.
The 90s are so in.
It really is. This will make so much money. Well, now that
so
we're
we
rich.
So we got Disney, the horse, plus mule ballroom dancing, and we got that guy's story. Let's do it.
Yep, we're totally loaded. We could shoot him in North Carolina.
Yeah.
And you know production, so perfect.
Perfect.
We'll throw up a budget right
Sounds
now.
Good.
We got a pen and paper already.
I do.
Thank you so much for doing
Thank
this.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you for introducing me to your dogs and
you're
giving
welcome.
Me pizza.
You're quite welcome. There you go. Love talking to her. Check her podcast out as well. Favorite places. We talk about it here. Hopefully I will do an episode at some point in the future. Also in the future, we have a new episode each and every Wednesday. So please join us then for a brand new episode of TV Guidance Counselor.
You pee in the kitchen and then there's a cat that walks around and you eat it.
Yeah.